السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Welcome to a live session of Ask an Imam. My name is Farhan Iqbal and this is the live program where you can ask any questions about Islam, the Ahmadiyya Muslim community or other world religions, faith matters, and answers are provided in light of resources that are found on the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, that is www.alislam.org. ALISLAM.org is the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. Today, I would like to talk about tackling materialism and worldliness. This is one of the themes of the address given to Lajna e Maila UK recently. This was on 26th of September 2021. The world head of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, His Holiness the Mirza Masroor Ahmad, may Allah be his helper, gave this address to the Lajna, the women's organization in the UK, the women's auxiliary organization of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community in the United Kingdom. So in order to access it, let me first show it to you that when, you know, if you would like to see the address, what you need to do is on alislam.org. Okay, there we go. So on alislam.org, you click on press releases. And when you click on press releases, you will come to this page, which basically contains all the latest press releases of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. And if you scroll down, you will see on September 28th, head of Ahmadiyya Muslim community concludes 42nd Lajna e Maila Ijtema UK with inspiring address. So in the very beginning, there is this very powerful quotation of Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmad, may Allah be his helper, that I would like to read. He says, "We are living in a time of ever-rising materialism and worldliness, where despite being intelligent and despite having eyes to see with, most people are living a life of spiritual and moral blindness in which they consider anything that shimmers or glistens to be made of gold. The world will be forced to admit that the riches of the world have left them spiritually penniless and morally bankrupt." So we are living in a world where we see so much materialism and so much spread of worldliness that it is causing people to turn away from religion, people to turn away from faith, and to turn towards these worldly things, materialistic things. And Hazur e Anwar, may Allah be his helper, talked about this. He spoke on this matter in his address. And he also spoke about the progress of technology. There are different kinds of technologies in the world that are progressing very fast. So he says that human knowledge and understanding has rapidly progressed in all secular fields. And as a result, communication is now extremely advanced and easy in comparison to previous eras. So this technological revolution that has taken place would not have seemed plausible even half a century ago. The rapid advance of communication through the development of the smartphone and other smart technologies could not have been envisaged even 10 or 15 years ago. So, you know, the technology, the easy access to information, it has its good side, but it also has its negative sides. It has those dark sides. So Hazur quoted the recent study that showed that Instagram, for instance, as a social media platform, is actually harmful for young girls. And similarly, in broader terms, you know, just because something is, it shimmers, or something that glistens to be made of gold, it should not be presumed to be made of gold. So these are the themes of this address. And you can read this address in full on this page. And before we move forward, just wanted to mention once again that this is an Ask an Imam where you can ask any questions about Islam, about the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, about other world religions. Answers are provided in light of resources found on the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim communities. Let me show you the ticker or the graphic here as well. Ask an Imam, where you can ask any questions. If you are on Twitter, you can use the mainstream itself to be part of this program. If you are on Facebook, you can use the comment section. And if you are on YouTube, you can use the live chat that is right next to the video to be part of this program, to be part of today's discussion. All right. I have received my first question. The question is, if a person is praying to Allah to reveal the truthfulness of Jamaat Ahmadiyya to them, how long should they pray for, and is there a recommended way to pray? If a person is praying to Allah in a very sincere way to reveal the truthfulness of Jamaat Ahmadiyya to them, if they are doing it in a very sincere way, it should not take long. There is one place that the promised Messiah alayhi salam has discussed this question. And he has said that, he even invited his opponents to come and to pray for 40 continuous days. Very sincerely, with their heart in it, they should pray to Allah to tell them whether or not the Ahmadiyya Muslim community is on the right path. And when they pray in that way, Allah will reveal the truth of the Jamaat to them. Because what is the alternative? There are many people who have prayed against the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, and none of their prayers have been successful. None of their prayers have enabled them to reach a point where they saw the decline of the Jamaat. So if a person is praying, this is one time they can follow. Let me show you where you can read about this. There's a book of the promised Messiah alayhi salam that is available on Al-Islam. It's called Nishan-e-Asmani. So on the very top here, click on Promised Messiah. If you scroll down to his books, you can come across that book. So it should be on this page. It should be translated as The Heavenly Sign or The Heavenly Decree. One of these books has this discussion. But since I'm not sure, it would be advisable that you have a look at the PDF and you go. I think one of these books gives this advice near the end, right? In the announcement, maybe at the end, there is some discussion on this. So 40 days is what I remember reading, but that can be confirmed. And you can send me an email as well. I know I have some emails that that do require me to respond to them. So inshallah, in the not so distant future, I will try to respond to them. But the reason why I would like to, I'm trying to search for it myself like this. One of the reasons is that I want to show you how easy it can be to search for these books and to search for the material that we are looking for. So try one of these books if you're not able to find an answer, full answer to your question. Write me an email and I will see if I can find the answer for you. One person has said that there is a prayer advice in Tohfa-e Baghdad. If you can also share the page number, maybe, because I don't recall what precisely the words of the prayer were. But definitely a good question in the sense that, we should know what advice to give to them. There is, of course, Surah Fatiha. Surah Fatiha has the words "Ihdina Siratul Mustaqim," guide us to the right path. Siratul Lazina Anamta Alayhim, the path of those upon you, upon whom you have bestowed your blessings. So if a person is sincerely offering this prayer and considering the truthfulness of the Jamaat, then inshallah Allah will reveal the truth to them. Again, the provision should be there that there is no malice in their heart. There is no attempt in their heart to, you know, if they see something or, you know, they try to explain it away and say that based on some bias. You know, even when people are deciding for a marriage proposal, we always advise them that, you know, you can go ahead and you know, only a proper istikhara, right? We have the istikhara prayer before the marriage. A proper istikhara can only work if you are sincere. If there is already some kind of, you're already inclined towards something and you're not fully sincere in your istikhara prayer, then it will not work and it will not have the kind of results that you want to see, right? Even in an istikhara, what is an istikhara for those who don't know? Istikhara prayer is a special prayer that we offer when we want Allah to help us decide whether something is good for us or not, right? So if something is, you know, not good for us, then Allah, we ask Allah to turn our hearts away from it. If something is good for us, we ask Allah to turn our hearts towards it, right? And I believe if my memory serves me right, what the Promised Messiah Islam proposes is the 40 days istikhara to learn about his truthfulness. But again, this is something that I would like to confirm. I have only one other question so far. That's why I'm just taking my time to answer your question here. And as far as the specific words from Tohfa-e Baghdad is concerned, that is also something, if you have the reference, we can look it up and see if that provides us the additional help that we are looking for in regards to this question. All right. But, you know, having answered your question, one more thing I want to say before I go on. Actually, I have two more questions now. Basically, sincere approach to the truth is what is required. I have been preaching the message of Islam Ahmadiyyat for more than 10 years now. Maybe even if you include the days when I was a student, even then I was preaching, if you include those, and maybe close to 15 years. And what I've noticed is that, you know, many a times people reject the message based on some bias or prejudice, right? Most of the time when people sincerely assess the message, and usually that happens only when you have built a good friendship with a person to whom you are preaching the message of Islam Ahmadiyyat. So if you are preaching to someone who is a friend, then those barriers will come down and their prejudice or their bias will go away, and you can have a sincere discussion with them. You know, and they can be sincere in assessing the truthfulness of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community or the truthfulness of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam. But if they have some bias that is preventing them from sincerely approaching this, then it can become difficult. Then that's part of the challenge, right? So that's also something to keep in mind. Was Mufti Muhammad Sadiq Sahib the first missionary to bring Islam in the United States? I believe it was, and this again, tough questions I'm getting today. This is again that I have to confirm, but I believe it was Fateh Muhammad Siyaz Sahib who went to, okay, that was probably to the United Kingdom and to Europe. Mufti Muhammad Sadiq Sahib came to the United States in the year 1920 or 21. So as a first missionary, yes. But as a first person to bring Islam to the United States, that wouldn't be correct. There were Muslims here in the United States even before then. If you go back into history And, you know, you look into the history of Muslims in North America, we have evidence of the slaves, some of them, who came to the United States, that they were Muslims. We have evidence of that. There is even a, you know, some historical evidence that proves this. There's a diary, for instance, of one slave from long ago, from 300-400 years ago, who wrote about his faith, and it is clear from his notes that he was a Muslim when he came to the United States. So Islam has its, you know, there are traces in the United States from that. And then, of course, there were immigrants that brought their faith with them and that were Muslims who came to the United States. And during the time of the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, the message of the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, was published in newspapers in the United States. So especially the challenge that the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, gave to John Alexander Dowie is published, and we have record of that. That during the time of the Promised Messiah, Islam, those newspaper articles were published, right? And if you look at some, you know, we have some publications like, you know, and some of them should be available even on alislam.org that carry some articles about the early history of Islam in the United States. In this case, you know, though I have not consulted this myself, but as an experiment, before I get to the next question, let me try and see if we can find something. You know, first missionary in the United States, right? It's amazing sometimes how good the results can be, right? So you can see missionaries, the first Ahmadiyya Muslim missionary in America. There's also already a resource, Ahmadiyyat in America, right? That is already telling me that it has. So, okay, so this is what I was talking about. This is the news piece about the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, that is published in the United States. It's dated October 26, 1903. So you can see that you can easily consult this. And yes, the Mr. Webb is accepted Islam during the Mr. Muhammad Alexander Russell Webb. He accepted Islam in the 1890s. So he's one of the first companions in the United States of the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, right? And to your question, I have only one more question to. So I have some time here. You know, the first Ahmadiyya Muslim missionary in America is Hazrat Dr. Mufti Muhammad Sadiq Sahib, who arrived in, who arrived in Philadelphia on February 15th, 1920, and was detained there. He was asked to write to the president in the country. The Secretary of State replied on behalf of the president, conveying his permission to him to preach Islam in the United States, right? So February 20th, 1920, is when he came, and the mosque that was built in Chicago, the first Ahmadiyya Muslim mosque in America. So my earlier confusion is fixed, and we have a resource telling us this. So, you know, this is a good exercise that, you know, any question you have on Al-Islam search bar, type it in, and not only yourself, but I also was able to learn this, you know, by this exercise. Okay, but of course, he was not the first to bring Islam to the country. Islam did exist. It can be argued that, in fact, it is true that the Ahmadiyya Muslim community is the first organization, first Muslim organization in the United States, because before then, there weren't you know, nationwide organizations of Muslims that existed. And it can also be said that the Ahmadiyya Muslim community is the first organized Muslim community to come to the United States, because before then, there were immigrants, there were independent Muslims, and there was no organized Muslim community in the United States. That could be argued. In fact, that is the truth. That is a factual statement. Okay, so I hope that answers your question. All right, one question from Farhan is that if you owe chanda to the jamaat and dowry to your wife, what takes precedence? You see, the dower money that is haq meher, that is owed to the wife, is an obligation. It's like qarz or a loan that you have to give. You are required. That's why it's called haq meher. It is the right of the wife to have it. But the way haq meher and chanda, they work independently. There is no comparison here. Chanda is basically money that we spend in the way of Allah. It is infaq fi sabilillah. It is money that is spent in the way of Allah. The haq meher is money that you owe, not you, but the man owes to his wife, right? There are multiple differences. One difference is that haq meher is something that you owe to your wife that you can give right away. It depends on the wife. If she asks for it, she has a right to have it as soon as possible. And if she wants to give some time for the husband to give it, she can give that time to the husband. So this is something that is to be mutually agreed upon. In the case of divorce, this becomes her right and has to be given to her. And let's say if the man dies, then this would be considered a loan or something that he owed to his wife, and it has to be paid first before the other inheritors get anything. This has to be paid, and just as a loan has to be paid. Now, chanda, or money that we spend in the way of Allah, donations, these are given on our income. So if a person has to give the most basic chanda or donation, it is 1/16, right? 1/16. Like 1/16 of his income has to be given in that. So he still has 15 out of 16 portions of his income that he can use to pay off his haq meher. It's not about a matter of precedence. Precedence comes when a person has died. And if a person has died, then of course haq meher or dowry would take precedence. But when it is a situation of everyday matters, in everyday matters, it's not a question of precedence. It's a question of how much money a person has, right? And they have a stable income. They should be giving their chanda required on that. And, you know, based on the rest of the amount they have, they should start giving the dower money to their wife. And in some arrangement, mutually understood arrangement, this could be paid in the form of installments or something like that, right? So it's not about precedences, you know. So I take issue with the question the way it's been framed. It's not about precedence. It's about the nature of the amount or the money owed and where it is owed, right? Okay. So I will answer. Okay, I will answer a couple of points more, unless if I get more questions, then I will take more questions. Otherwise, after these couple of questions, we can conclude. Will Malfuzat Volume 3 in English be available on Al Islam website anytime soon? You see, anytime a book is available, we announce it. And what you can do if you are eager to see that is you can check back from Al Islam the what's new section. So in fact, just you know, a response to three questions of a Christian by Hazrat Hakim, Maulana Hakim Nuruddin Sahib. This is a book that has been recently added. Hallmarks of Saints is a book, new translation is available. That, you know, and this book, Refutation of the Divinity of Christ, that I've talked about in a recent Ask an Imam stream. You know, even I try to announce these things. So if the Malfuzat translation, or when the Malfuzat translation rather comes, it will be announced here. So if you don't have the chance to check frequently, you can come to this page and go through the list of translations, right? So they, these the list of announcements, rather, of whatever is new on alislam.org. Okay, so this is where the announcements will happen. Now, as per when exactly the Malfuzat translation will be available, Allah knows best. It depends on the process. It depends on how the book publishing process has taken place in the UK. Once it is published, then they send the PDF to Al Islam team. So it should not take too long now, right? If especially if the translation is already complete and it is already finished, then and it has already been published in book form, in print form, then it should not be long before it becomes available on alislam.org. Okay, one comment that has came, and that after this we will conclude, is that one is a debt. Yes, that's a word I was looking for actually. Haq mehr or dowry is a kind of a debt that you owe, right? I was using the word loan, but that is not maybe the best word to use here. And the other is chanda, which is voluntary donations. Yes, I can agree with that chanda is something that we give voluntarily, right? And the haq mehr is part of our sharia. But then again, when we say that we give voluntary donations or spending in the way of Allah, that is based on what the Quran says. The Quran says that you should spend in the way of Allah. And in following this commandment, we spend in the way of Allah by giving chanda, and we do the spending through our nizam or the organization of the jamaat. One more question I have, and after that definitely we will finish. Is it better to recite one or two verses with long commentary or to recite one or two ruku with just translation if you don't have time for both? You see, Tayyib, I would say that you should try to find time for both, because recitation of the Quran on a daily basis, that's required. And it's good to do one ruku or two ruku, even more than that. That simple recitation is required. As far as translation is concerned, or commentary is concerned, you do as much as you can. But instead of trying to differentiate between these two, you should say that I should recite one ruku or two ruku. Better to do two ruku every day. Recitation is absolutely important. And if I don't have time in the morning, if you think that you don't have time in the morning, then maybe later in the day you can come back and read the translation. But recitation of the Quran in the morning should be something that is absolute. And as far as translation is concerned, instead of saying I will read one ruku with one ruku of translation, read the translation and commentary, but consider it as a separate unit. Recitation of the Arabic of the Holy Quran should be considered fundamental. Translation and commentary should come next. And if you don't have time to go into the commentary, you can do it later, or even the translation. But the Arabic recitation of the Arabic should be essential. It is crucial. And when it comes to the translation or the commentary, one advice I would like to give is that you should make it a daily habit to read one page, right? Instead of going and saying, this commentary is 5 pages, it's too long. Don't worry about that. Make it a habit to read at least one page, right? Maybe translation plus commentary, one page, or one page of translation and one page of commentary every day. And you will see that it is a simple exercise. It doesn't take more than 5 minutes. And it can become a habit, a daily habit. When it becomes a daily habit, then in the long run, you wouldn't miss it. Okay? That's all the time I had. I really appreciate all of you joining me for this program today. Jazakumullah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammadin. Barik wa sallam.